two things that I have to watch out for. So first of all, there's this surface for which I compute the minimal area, and then I get the formula from the slide before. If you make this curve larger and larger and larger, what happens in a black hole background is that a certain critical length of the interval, it snaps. And it snaps into two pieces. One that hugs the black hole, and one that now goes on the other side of the black hole. So it's computing the entanglement entropy of the complement of the region that I had before. So there are two answers depending on how big your interval is for computing the entanglement entropy of the black hole.
Can you get more entropy than the black hole? So you're summing two entropies.
Yeah, you're summing two entropies. Yeah, so this is...
So how can the answer be bigger than the black hole entropy on its own? SBH.
You have to compute this, and the entanglement entropy is a non-indefinite sign.
Okay.
I didn't tell you what it is.
The entanglement entropy can be non-zero even in vacuum, right?
Yeah.
If the Ryu-Takinagi formula is meant to choose the minimal area surface, why can't you just, in the second picture, throw away the part of the surface wrapping the black hole?
But because that's the minimal area surface.
But
that's the...
Surely the... If you threw away that bit, the remaining surface would still be...
No, no, but... yeah, but you can't... There's something called the homology constraint that has it at a critical length of the interval, this is the contribution to the entanglement entropy. So you can't throw it away. That makes sense. Yeah, so that's the answer for the black hole. There are two regimes depending on, well, two answers depending on how much access you have to the CFD. Now let's compute this for the microstate. I said we don't really know in general what the microstates of a black hole look like in gravity. So I will use this magical replica trick formula and compute this four-point function. If you make an assumption that in this picture there's only one of those operators that contributes, which goes under the name vacuum block dominance, then you can fairly easily compute the entanglement entropy for the microstates. Again, there's two answers depending on how large the interval is. And now, in order to compute the Holevo information, which will tell me about distinguishing these microstates from the black hole, I have to take a difference of these two. So let's just do this calculation. So L crit is bigger than pi r, which is half the size of the CFD. So if I look at small intervals, those two answers are the same, and so the difference is zero. Then if you look at very large regions, if you have access to a very large amount of the CFD or the space-time, again, these terms are the same, but there's also the black hole entropy, so that's what you get for very large regions. And then there's some expression in between. And the thing that I want to focus on for the rest of this talk is when this region is very small. So you have a very small interval that you have access to, that's very little amount of information from the CFD or from the bulk side. This is the region that I will focus on. So what these people here showed by taking the difference of those two things, is that unless you have access to half the size of the CFD, so half of this, unless you have access to this, you cannot at all distinguish the microstates from the black hole. So you need a huge amount of information to be able to distinguish them. And I'm going to question that in a particular setup. So here again, this picture. So unless you have access to half the CFD, there is nothing you can say, and then there's something you can say. At a certain point, you know everything. Okay, so now in order to question this, I have to look at the assumptions and ask whether the assumptions are valid in order to make this conclusion. So the point here is I want to have a distinguishability of microstates from the black hole, even if I don't know a lot. And I'm going to ask whether this is possible. Okay, so now I have to talk a bit about black holes as thermal systems. So we know they are described by coarse properties like mass, charge, and angular momentum, obey the first law of thermodynamics, so there's a good chance that they actually are thermal systems, and general relativity is the effective macroscopic description. Now, if you want to describe a gas that is described by microscopic parameters like pressure, volume, and temperature, then we know that different microstates have the same pressure, volume, and temperature as microscopic properties. And a similar thing should be true for black holes if they are like thermal systems. And like we have a molecular description for the gas in Boltzmann sense, there's a microscopic description available for certain classes of black holes. And that description is string theory. So now to tell you about black holes and string theory and how to distinguish microstates in that framework, let's go back and ask what black holes are in a quantum mechanical sense. So black holes should be bound states, and they should have many degenerate vacuum. They have a huge entropy, e to the 10 to the 19, the center of our galaxy. In string theory, we have strings and brains. So brains are locations where strings can end, and then I can also put smaller brains in bigger brains. So the idea is that black holes should be understood as bound states of strings and brains. Okay, but if you look at this picture, you ask me, what have these strings and brains really to do with black holes? If you take a lot of them together, they will become very heavy, and then they will backreact on the ambient geometry. So if you let gravity, run, these bunch of brains and strings stuck together will actually form a black hole. And so you have, in different regimes, two differently looking low energy effective descriptions. One where you have a bunch of strings and brains, whose degeneracy gives rise to the entropy, and the other where you have a black hole, whose entropy is given by the area. And this is not just some waving around and some schematics. This can be actually made very precise. So for particular classes of black holes in string theory, the supersymmetric ones, you can show that the number of degenerate brain configurations is actually the area of the corresponding black hole over 4 times Newton's constant. Okay, so we have this nice framework now, and now we can ask, in this framework, can I distinguish microstates from the black hole? Okay, so the simplest system, and if I have no clue, I should start trying to solve the simplest system first. And the simplest such system is when I take two types of brains and put them together in a certain way. So I have a brain, a D1 brain, which has one spatial direction, and I wrap it on a circle. And then I take a D5 brain, so it's five spatial directions, and I also wrap it on a circle, and then some other four dimensions. These two brains put together in that way, if you let it backwrap on a geometry, create a new horizon region that looks like a three-dimensional entropy Sitter space and a sphere. Now I invoke the CTO correspondence and tell you that this three-dimensional entropy Sitter space can be described by a two-dimensional CFD with a certain parameter central charge that gives rise to the entropy of the system. There are two things that I have to know about the system in order to compute this average relative entropy that tells me about distinguishability. First, for this system, these D1 and D5 brains stack together in a certain way, the corresponding black hole, which has the name BDD black hole, the microstates of this system are known. And it takes a fancy name of Ramon ground states. So there's an degeneracy of these ground states that gives rise to the entropy. Okay, let me skip over this. The other thing that you need to know is that this sphere plays a very important role. You can put angular momentum on this sphere, and there are two types of angular momentum that you can put. It's called left and right moving angular momentum. And this angular momentum on the sphere will imply that I can organize my CFD in a certain way according to what the values of this angular momentum are. So most states in the system have angular momentum that have a size that goes with the square root of n or c. But there are some states, some rare states, that have a very large angular momentum, and they go with c. So remember before c and n was taken very large to have a well-defined description, so these have really a huge angular momentum. And it's because of these rare, yet states that appear in the ensemble, that the assumption that I earlier mentioned in computing distinguishability of microstates is violated. So this is like if I take the air in this room, there's still a microstate, but I can put all the air in one corner. It's not a very likely microstate, but it's a microstate. So it's part of the ensemble. And similarly here, these microstates are very rare, but they're part of the ensemble. Okay, so now what I need to do is I need to compute what I said before, the reduced density matrix for these microstates in the small interval L, and then see whether I still get zero at the end of the day for the average relative entropy. So let me not go into the details of these calculations. Let me just give you the result for the average relative entropy. So these left and right angular momenta label my CFD. So I had before I had sum over I, pi, rho I. This is now the density matrix for a microstate. This is the weight with which the microstate appears. And now I compute the average relative entropy or Hall Lebesgue information for the black hole in interval L. By computing the entanglement entropy of the black hole minus the weighted sum over the entanglement entropies of the microstates. Long story short, what I would get is the previous contribution, which I call the vacuum piece because it used this vacuum drop approximation, which is zero, which we saw it was a flat line, it was zero, there was nothing there. And now because of these large angular momentum states, I get a correction. And this correction is some number that doesn't scale with the parameter of the theory, it's just some number. And then the length of the interval divided by the radius of the interval to get something dimensionless. So there is a positive contribution to this quantity. Let me illustrate this with this picture. So there's a small but non-vanishing average relative entropy for the system because of these very rare but very rare states that have this very dominant feature of having large angular momentum. And it's because of these states that my average relative entropy is now non-zero. And this means, and this is true even if I take the interval that I can make measurements at to be very small. So this means I only need a very small amount of the CFT or a holography, the space-time, in order to distinguish microstates from a black hole on average, and not half the CFT. So this is maybe surprising because you would think that typical states are very look very much like the black hole. Yes.
You had that coefficient alpha,
mm-hmm.
and you showed that it goes as L squared. So if I go to the next slide, the picture. So does the entropy increase quadratically and more or less
so
reach the midpoint?
I should say, this is the region that I'll focus on. I don't know anything about the rest because
the
computation.
But if you just took your L squared with that coefficient,
yes.
does it kind of roughly come here?
So this is, this is.
So it roughly comes there, I see.
Well, I can only compute here. The rest is question mark because the tools available for computing the corrections are restricted to this small region. So you could have initially thought, oh, well, if you don't know, if you cannot compute this quantity here, this Hall-Lebesgue information, for a very large region, then you will never see a non-zero because.
But can't you have a thought experiment where you have a lot of infinitesimal regions? The total information when you sum all of them is known. And if you know the answer for a small one, you can fix the parameter, the coefficient such that
so
you get the total.
Actually, if you have a CFD where you have lots of disconnected pieces, you have to, there are different, it's not just summing up these things.
Because there is interrelationship.
Yeah.
I see.
Yeah. And for many, I think for the tools that I used, this is not even known for, say, more than two distinct point intervals. But I'm not an expert on that. There is a lot of activity going on in trying to compute the relative entropy and not just the average relative entropy, and this is extremely hard. This is why we resorted to taking the average, which is kind of the only computation that you can do at this point in order to say something about distinguishability. And the surprising thing here is that the tools available to compute this thing are restricted to small regions, yet you find that this quantity, this average relative entropy, is non-zero, and it's not suppressed by the parameter of the theory that is taken large, but it's really some number and then some dimensionless ratio. So it's small in this regime where we can compute it, but it's non-zero. So this might give hope that you don't have to know you don't have to know an enormous amount of information about the CFT or access to the space-time in order to, on average, distinguish microstates from black hole. But as I said in the disclaimer before, I am not making any observational statements here, so you will have to make do with that. Okay, so actually I'm actually at the end of my talk, so I told you that in particular systems in string theory where we can compute, where we know what the microstates are, we can compute this quantity, this average relative entropy, which allows us to ask whether you can distinguish the microstates from the black hole on average. And they showed that even if you have just a tiny amount of CFT or space-time available, then on average you can distinguish microstates from the black hole because of the properties of very rare states. And I'll leave this on the board, and thank you for your attention.
Whole analysis was for ADS3 CFT2.
Yes.
So is it generalized to other dimensions?
Yes, so that's the question.
Oh, that's a question mark then, okay.
Yeah, so.
Open question, okay. So you don't have the answer.
2D CFTs are, I don't have the answer. 2D CFTs are very particular CFTs. There's lots of symmetry, so there's lots of tools available for computing things. There is a system that's very similar to the, first of all, the more difficult part of the first question to ask is, what other kinds of black holes or systems that can you do this? The one that I showed, the one that I used, is one where you know the microstates, where you have an explicit description of the CFT microstates. Those black holes are actually black holes that have a zero horizon area, and they have no temperature. So you might want to ask, can you say something similar about black holes that actually have a macroscopic horizon area? Those would be those kinds of black holes, where you add another guy, where you add momentum that travels along the 31.5 grains. But for these black holes, it's much more difficult, the system, and the ensemble hasn't been done in any usable way for these questions. You can then ask, can I go away from the zero temperature limit, which I was really using and putting into the rock? For this, we know even less about the microstates.
So where do you make that limit? By making n large?
This was when I took the system that I wanted to study. So the system that I wanted to
was
study
zero
was a supersymmetric black hole.
Because
but
it's extreme.
States, yeah.
Okay.
But the degeneracy of states gives you the entropy. And the other thing about supersymmetry is that for people who do CFT computations, correlation functions, they should have shouted at me and saying, oh, you're cheating, what you're doing is illegal.
Well,
because because you cannot take a computation at weak coupling and say that's the answer for strong coupling, because the supergravity description is dual to the CFT at strong coupling, and what I was doing was doing computations at weak coupling. But the thing about having a supersymmetric black hole is that certain things are protected, and in particular, the microstates of this black hole that I had had the property that this quantity J that I was secretly using to compute this are protected operators, or they are protected three-point functions in computing this, so it was possible to compute something. But if you go away from supersymmetry, things become very hard. So that's why we use toy models to learn about something. First understand the easy problem and then hopefully make progress in going to the real problem. Yeah. Okay, well, let's thank Andrea and